Welcome to the Quintin and Ramenia Show, where Christianity is an action. I'm Quintin.
And I'm Ramenia.
Today's topic is the love of God. Now, you're probably wondering, what do I mean by that? Well, we live in the beautiful United States of America, and we have had privileges that most people don't have. Worshiping God freely here in the United States. We've had a few hiccups, such as prayer being taken out of schools. Yeah. But prior to that, when prayer was in schools, it was really powerful. The foundation of the United States, the Ivy League schools, Yale, Princeton, Harvard, were actual schools for ministry, for preachers, ministers. So they trained the preachers and ministries in every area, covering economics, covering business, religious life. So the school system was blessed. The country was blessed. Yeah, there were quite a few hiccups throughout our history. However, we, at this present state, we're at 2022. We have actually lived a very blessed life.
Yes.
We've had an opportunity to do so much. Which brings me to the thought, since the topic is the love of God, the question we should ask ourselves, how much have we done for God? You know? We have brothers and sisters in Christ in all parts of the world that have been persecuted, that they've lost their churches, that have lost their homes, that have lost their lives. And we still hear, case in point, the, what's Ukrainian? Ukraine, the country of Ukraine. Now, we know that that battle is still going on. And I get reports from certain ministries that the Christians that did stay because they wanted to stay are being persecuted consistently, as well as the our brothers and sisters who don't look like us, or shall I say do look like us, from various parts of the world that did establish themselves in Ukraine. And we're here in the United States, and we're very comfortable. We don't see too much discrimination against being a believer. And yet, God loves us and blessed us to be here, to be able to spread the gospel, to spread the good news.
Yeah, but I beg to differ. There is prejudice against us as believers. It's gotten to the point in this world that anybody can have a voice on anything, but if we talk about God, then we can be ostracized. You can show any and everything on television that you want to show, but people have problem with ministries being on TV. I've even heard ministers say, well, if I find out that my members are giving money to ministries on television, I'm not even going to pray for them. I'm glad you are yet so bold to think you have that kind of power, because those things such as that that you're doing, you don't know that that person that your member is giving to is not the reason that you're getting anything from the member at all, because they're being taught to sow on a regular basis. And like us, who are a television ministry, this is what we're doing. We are radio ministry. We are international radio ministry. We often comment to our listeners that you should be giving to your local church. Wherever you're being fed regularly, you should be giving to that. And it's because we're saying that, in many cases, that some people are giving to it. So there's not only just prejudice in general, there's even prejudice within the body of one another. So I beg to differ that we don't have the isms and schisms of that. I mean, we can freely preach and speak and say what we feel out in public more so without being afraid that somebody's going to kill us or shoot us or whatever. But even on the flip side of that, we got people showing up at people's churches waiting outside to shoot them or coming in the churches boldly enough to shoot them. And they've been doing that for years because we know of a man of God who, if not for the angels of God, blessing him, mm-hmm. somebody came into the church point blank close shooting at him, and the bullets never, none of the bullets touched him because mm-hmm. it was the grace of God covering him. So we do have freedoms that we didn't, that a lot of other places don't have, but I would beg to differ when it comes to even such a thing as small as freedom of speech, which that's not small, that's a big thing. But when it comes to freedom of speech, even, you know, you can be doing anything under the sun, your little heart desires that you want to do, and you can speak all over it mm-hmm. whenever you want to. But let us start talking about Jesus too long, too loud for around too many people, and that becomes a problem. So we don't have the speech until they want something from God. If there's a flood, oh, well, you know, they should open their church and let people come in. If there's a hurricane, a tornado, whatever, mm-hmm. well, they should open their church and let people come in. Oh, you don't want to come to the church. Mm-hmm. When it's just a regular basic Sunday, Saturday, whatever meeting they're having, we don't want to come to the church then. But, and we ostracize the men and women of God that we are privileged enough to see speak out publicly about God. We mm-hmm. want to ostracize them. I cannot say how many people on YouTube I have never, ever, 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 ever heard of who will put up an 8-minute snippet about somebody and people just run with it because that's the gospel truth. You won't look at the whole video. It's an hour, hour and a half, 2-hour video, but you'll listen to somebody you don't even know uh-huh. say a negative 8-minute snippet about somebody and, oh, well, they're just horrible. They're just terrible. Really? Now, well, let us put some snippets of you on YouTube and see how you feel
about it. I like the
way
you said that. It's the issues that the children of God, or shall I say the body of Christ, has had. It's been an issue. It's mm-hmm. been a problem. However, there's two things we need to look at. One is the church brought a lot of things on ourselves.
True.
Such as, one, we don't let certain people in our church. Two, it's sort of like a fraternity or a sorority mm-hmm. or a gang
true.
Where the church is not actually acting. Right. They're not acting in actually going out in community and for that matter, being a part of the community to make the change. They're not actually going out and praying for the sick. They're not actually going out and causing the sick to get healed. They're not actually going out and feeding just someone to get a quick meal. But the feeding the people so that they do what? They are now prosperous and they're growing more. There are certain ministries that do
There's a lot of ministries that are doing that. The one with the 8-minute snippet is doing that. They're doing that. I mean, has a disaster relief ministry that goes forth.
Yes.
Doing stuff like
yes.
that.
Yes,
but
yes.
But they're still talking smack about them.
Now, those are large ministries, and it's a blessing, but let's look at the small ministries. Let's say right here in Dayton, in the greater Dayton area. There are a few big ministries in the greater Dayton area that are a blessing. Mm-hmm. However, there's quite a few churches, and let's just put it out there. You could actually go down in certain parts of the greater Dayton area, and there's like 5 to 6 different numbers of churches on one street.
Right.
And the question is, who's actually blessing anyone during that time? I mean, if 5 churches on the same street and you could actually look down the street and see all 5, that there should be a question for the non-believer, for the sinner. They're thinking, well, we got 5 different churches. Don't they believe the same thing? And of course, they can't answer it. Why? Because they don't visit each church. But the love of God behind this whole thing is we still have some freedoms right here.
Yeah, I agree with that.
To be able to step out, to be able to become the actual child of God that God wants us to be.
Yeah,
to actually be effective and so on. And then there is number two, and this is what I was going to talk about. There is the church that's actually moving, the body of Christ that's actually moving in the background. You don't hear about them announcing anything, but you see a change in the community.
Yeah,
you see a change on certain streets. You see a change, and with those changes, some people question and say, wow, how did that happen? That's when the move of God is working. The move of God is powerful. That's the power of the love of God, because God is working things out despite the fact of what's being seen in the natural, what's being seen out in public.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of it. So here's a big challenge. As we look at this, we're just about to go back into the school system, the school year.
Right.
Now, in the South, they've already started. Kentucky, Tennessee, a couple of other southern states have already started school. And, you know, they start early. They start real early. It's like the second week of August now. Sometimes, is this the second week of August?
The beginning of the second week of August.
Which means the teachers had to be back the very first week.
Yeah.
And we already know about the shooting that just happened just, what was it, 2 months ago, 3 months ago, in Texas.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That Texas shooting. Now everybody is talking about protection. They're talking about hyping up the security measures. They're talking about the question as to whether there should be what? A police officer in the school. And when we say police officer, we're talking not high school, that they've already had, that's what they call resource officers in certain schools. But they already have police officers in the schools. Now we're talking about having police officers in K through 8 schools, kindergarten schools, primary schools, so that the children are protected in such a manner. Those kinds of things are getting wild, and now we're coming back into school. So what should we do? It should not just be a prayer thing that's going on. And that's a good thing. That's the number one thing we should do is pray. Now, that's part of the love of God. We have that privilege and opportunity to pray for protection for our children in the schools, our grandchildren in the schools, and just children in our neighborhoods who are going to the schools. Now, I know some people will say, well, I don't have any children or grandchildren going to school, so why should I pray? Yeah, but some of those same kids are going down your street. They going past your house. And if you're not praying for them, then they may be one that may rob you. They may be one to, you know what I'm saying?
The person saying that is not a child of God. I mean, how are you going to
There's a lot of folks like that.
A child of God if you don't want to pray for people because you don't have that going. No, you're not a child of God.
That's happened.
No. You don't know God. You cannot have a relationship with God because we pray for everybody, even people we don't like.
Right.
We pray for them.
Right.
So, I mean, I'm just being real. Y'all know I'm the raw one. He the learned one. I will gladly tell you, I'm not a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
That is not my gift.
Right.
I cannot do it. I'm a mom. Because I'm a mom, I can't be a teacher. But for somebody that don't, because we don't have any kids in the school system here.
No,
our kids,
no,
our grandkids are all out of state.
Sure.
So we have no kids in this this area. But, I mean, we still pray for the children.
That's right.
You know, we pray for the ones in our ministry, though we've not done like the group one because they've not gone back to school. But even the school that we're in, we're located in Emerson Academy now. As of June 5th, we've gone back inside. We're at Emerson Academy on Sundays.
That's right.
And on Wednesdays. Wednesdays at 7, we have Bible study. And then Sundays, we have Faith School at 10, corporate prayer at 10:30, and morning worship at 11. So what we did, because we are housed in that school. We are the representatives of God in that school.
That's right.
So we, before, because we knew the teachers were coming back in this week, mm-hmm. when we went in to set up, we prayed over the entire school. I mean, we right. walked the school. Trust me, my watch could tell you. Up the stairs, down the stairs, we walked the school. Mm-hmm. So, but we should all have that mindset, because as you said, we don't know who this child will be.
That's right.
At some point, we don't know what's going on in their lives. We don't even know if they have any peace going on mm-hmm. at their home. So it is our job as the body of Christ. I mean, what if God was like that? Well, like at a certain point, well, I ain't got no kids over there. Why should I? You know, we don't stop and think about stuff like that. So I myself, as a woman of God, not even as a pastor, when right. I was just simply a woman of God, I can't fathom anybody calling themselves a child of God who would say, well, I ain't got no kids. And I mean, I'll say I ain't got no kids in there. I ain't going to no basketball games no more. I ain't going to no volleyball games no more. I ain't going to no track meets, baseball games, cookouts, none of that stuff. Well, if Mr. Pierce were still here, I'd still go, because that was my buddy. But, you know, I can say that I'm not going to go to certain events. But even with having young ones in our ministry, mm-hmm. like the little kids and then the teenagers. Yeah, if they have something going on and they ask me to come, or sometimes just to go and support them, I'm going to go to that.
Right.
I ain't got no kids there. Mm-hmm. You know, I ain't got to go. I ain't got to do that. But because of the heart we should have for the community, if you don't do anything else, you need to be praying for
that's
the
right.
kids walking down the street. Because how you know a little Bobo ain't messing with somebody who doing drive-bys and shooting
that's
at
right.
your house?
That's right.
You better pray for him.
And you know, it's not funny, but whenever I hear about an incident of a school being shot up, everybody begins to say, well, let's pray. Well, my question is, what were you doing before that happened?
Exactly.
Were you praying before for the protection of the students?
Right.
Were you praying for the school? Now, most people will say, but that's not part of our ministry. But that's just it. Wherever you are, if there's a school close by, that is your ministry. That is your ministry to pray for them.
That is your territory. So, yes, it is your
that's right.
part of your ministry. Whatever your domain
that wherever you live,
territory,
your neighborhood,
say,
that's right,
whatever the radius is of you, like for our what I consider our borders, Salem, Free Pike, Connector, Turner,
mm-hmm.
all in that area mm-hmm. is our territory, and even beyond that area is our territory.
That's
but
right.
when I'm talking about the boundaries of our community,
yes.
per se, those are the boundaries we go to. In that big square radius,
that's
anything
right.
that falls within that radius is definitely our territory, and it is definitely our responsibility to pray over it. But because we are in, we're on the borderline of Trotwood and Dayton,
yes.
that's our territory as well,
mm-hmm.
Trotwood and Dayton.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe I got a different kind of mindset than some people, but you know, I have the understanding that, you know, that's where we get to the praying for me, my four, and no more.
Right.
No, kind of right. like on the, what was that, head of state where the guy would say, God bless America and no place else.
Right.
God bless my community and no place else. Bless right. my house and no place. That's stupid.
It is.
Because
it
you
is.
Still have to interact with these people in this community.
Right. But the love of God says we pray for all. We
yes.
pray for protection for all.
We do.
We pray for, and this is the beauty of it. The scripture actually gives us an opportunity to ask God to open up the eyes of the understanding of those who are having issues.
Right.
That's powerful. That
right.
comes from Ephesians chapter 1, that we can pray for those people, even if they're not saved. We can pray, Lord, open up their eyes. Why? Because according to the scripture, it says, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, Satan has blinded the minds of those who don't know God. Well, if they're blinded, they can be unblinded.
Yeah.
And as long as we're praying for them to be unblinded so they can actually see the truth,
right.
then it will make sense. But yeah. if we're not praying for any of that, and we hear about a shooting, we hear about a house being blown up. We hear about a school being attacked. We hear about a store being firebombed. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We hear about the guys who are doing, and the people who are doing donuts all around the city. if you're not praying, the thought is you're not doing your job. Because Paul said, by the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, it says pray without ceasing.
Right.
And what does that mean? Well, you should be praying, asking the Lord. Whenever you get a yearning, an unction of the Holy Ghost to just pray, do it.
Yeah.
Whether it's in English or in your prayer language, just do it. Why? Because the love of God loves us enough to give us warnings.
Yeah.
To give us supernatural warnings.
Right.
I guarantee you that there were some children during that Texas event that were... they had the love of God and they made it safely. They made it safe. I can guarantee you that. Why? Because God always warns his children.
Mm-hmm.
Always warns his children.
And he always
That's
has
love.
A
That's
yes.
the love of God.
Yes, it is.
He doesn't want you to be hurt. He doesn't want you to be damaged. He doesn't want you to be confused. He doesn't want you to be to be hoodwinked, if you want to put it that way. But this is a perfect time to pray for the schools, pray for the children, pray
right.
for the neighborhoods, and then continuously pray. Because we got 9 months that schools are in. 9 months. And the pandemic is not over. Hello, did you hear that? It's not over. They've opened up the communities. They've opened up the businesses. But the pandemic is not over.
Yeah.
You know, some people, we've been places, and they are still not walking around with their masks as if it's all over. No, it's not. No, it's not. We still need to pray for protection from all the sickness and diseases that are mm-hmm. around, because we keep hearing about the what? And they've been slowly downplaying it, the different variants, right?
Yeah. Well, now, because they're talking about monkeypox.
Yeah, monkeypox.
We've gone from the pandemic. They were talking, there was some kind of bird flu,
mm-hmm.
and that didn't catch on, so now it's monkeypox.
Right.
It'll be giraffe measles soon, you know, if that is a thing. I mean,
monkey
and not pox. To downplay this, but it's amazing how they're trying to bring fear into us. When, if we take the time to use precautions, then we're not concerned about stuff
right.
like that anyway. We don't have to be concerned
mm-hmm.
about that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if I am my brother's keeper, which yes, you are.
Yes.
If I am my brother's keeper, I'm going to be mindful of those around me. Because again, yeah, the masks can be daunting. Yeah, they can be a pain. They smell like sneeze or what have you. Especially if you're, I mean, whatever we eat, like we went to the Mexican restaurant once. My man smelled like Mexican food for I don't know how long. It smells like gum when I chew gum. It picks up those smells.
Right.
But, you know, in the laughter of that, we have to remember some people, that's their only line of defense.
It is.
Because their immune system is a particular way, so they can't get vaccinated.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'd say it many times in the school, while the people who are complaining and talking about their kids rising out and told y'all kids, make sure you exercise your rights at home with your mom and dad since they say you got rights.
Right.
But while we're talking about their rights, they're not stopping to think about there were at least two stories here in the Dayton area about little kids who'd had cancer.
Yes.
And they've been out of school for a very long time. And they finally mm-hmm. got cleared to go back to school.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about your child not being able to have a regular life. But what about these little kids who've
right.
been like months at a time
mm-hmm.
out of school, who finally get to have some kind of normalcy
right.
by going back to school, but because you don't want to put a mask on your little one, you're jeopardizing the health of this little one.
That's right.
Because
That's
their
right.
mom wants them around just as much as you want yours around.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we get so petty at things. But the Bible says that man will become lovers of themselves
yes.
more than God.
Yes.
It's a me generation.
That's right.
Everybody
That's
got
right.
rights. Everybody should be heard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a do what you want to do kind of thing
mm-hmm.
until you need somebody.
Right.
Then they're supposed to not do what they want to do to take care of you
yes.
while you're doing what you want to do. Yes. And that's why you ended up in a situation that you're in.
Right.
So it's kind of a rough thing. But again, we always have to have the heart of God, the love of God to do. To be mindful of other people around us.
We do.
Because it's never about me.
That's right. That's
right. I am never the center of attention. Not for me, I shouldn't be. For other people, have at it. But for me, my attention should always be on other people and what I can do
right.
for other people. And, you know, that's one of the greatest things that I think we picked up from being a Without Walls ministry and getting out in the community and being in the parks and interacting with the people out in the parks and seeing their hearts. I told this once before. I can't remember whether it was on here or on the radio, but when we talked about the one Father's Day that we were in McIntosh and we had, like, we weren't under the shelter, we were somehow ended up in the benches because the benches were all off to the side.
Right.
And then they had the regular benches that are made there, but they had park benches. And there were, like, I don't know how many guys surrounding there. And we got to hear stories
yes.
from them. I guess it was because it was Father's Day and some of them weren't going to get to see their kids. It was a vulnerable moment
yep.
for them. And they were opening their hearts and they were sharing. And that's not always something that we're going to get
right.
in the building from those guys.
That's right.
You know, we may get it from our parishioners, and it's important to get it from our parishioners too, but to get out in the community mm-hmm. and really get to hear the hearts of the people, man, that gives you a whole different perspective on what's going on
it
in
does.
The world. You know, there are some people that are like on their own page and they're gonna stay on their own page. But then there are so many other people that just wanna be heard.
That's right.
And we all wanna be heard. We all wanna be seen. We all wanna be known. We don't necessarily wanna be known for the things we're known for, but you know, everybody wants to be relevant to somebody.
That's right.
So okay. that's our job as the body. I mean, I'm not saying that we gonna just let people run roughshod and do whatever they want. No, we're not gonna do that.
No.
Just like in the schools, we can't just let the kids run all willy-nilly doing whatever they want.
Right.
But I mean, the awesomeness of it, even I call myself, I was the kindergarten guru toward the end of the year because when Quentin had the kindergartners, he had them right after lunch and me and Quentin video chat at lunch. After he finishes eating, we'll video chat. And it got to the point where he'd tell me about little kids, so then he'd show me the little kids, and then he'd show the little kids to me. By the end of the school year, they would be lined up waiting to say hello to me. And the awesomeness about that is they just want to be relevant.
That's
and
right.
if we can get them while they're little, kindergartners, then, you know, I'm excited for when they come back to school next week. So the ones who were in that particular class to see if they remember Dr. Jordan's wife and whether he talks to whether they can see Dr. Jordan's wife again. Because it's important that we start when they're young. If we put more into them while they were little,
right.
we wouldn't have to deal with as much stuff. We talked about something else with we were talking about. No, it was me and my sister. We were talking. My sister is a chef, and she does. She has a business called Tomorrow's Kitchen, and what she does is go into schools or different programs, and she teaches kids how to make things from like what she was doing was what's in my cupboard. Mm-hmm. So, because you don't know, a lot of recipes will have stuff that ain't nobody got that.
Right.
So she teaches them how to use the different things in their cupboard and mm-hmm. like make them be something that mm-hmm. you want to eat.
Right.
Not just something in your cupboard, a can you dump something. No, she teaches them how to do that. And she was talking about how the importance in the classes when there are different kids in different places, which is what you do too when you elect officers in your class.
Right.
It gives kids vestation.
Yes.
It makes them feel I'm important and I'm doing something. And mm-hmm. it's got to be that way from the smallest task, mm-hmm. picking up pencils or whatever, to whoever the president of the class is, treasurer, the officer, such as that.
Right.
And if we do that with the kids and help get them vested. That one time, my thought has been, and I think it's too late this year, but next year, in dealing with the kids in the ministry, because we'll have been in a building for a year, so I expect to have a lot of kids. We need to start doing something like gardening, or because I noticed one thing Dayton is big about is they have lots of community gardens. They have the solar garden, which is amazing.
It's amazing.
Over in Edgemont. But they also have, in different communities, they come together and they put together these gardens.
Yes.
And the kids can go out and participate too. Mm-hmm. If we took more time to vest our kids in the community, there'd be less drama, less mess, less stupidity going on. And especially if we catch them while they're little, you know, if I'm out there, I'm little Sally, and I'm planting these plants, and little Johnny come like he's gonna step on them, I'm gonna push Johnny down. Probably not the best thing to do, but I'm gonna do it anyway, because I planted that. Don't mess up my plant.
Right.
You know, I should probably show Johnny how to plant his own plant, but I'll probably push him down.
Right.
So if we get them interested, and not everybody's going to want to do gardening. That is, again, one of the rough things about them taking the extracurriculars out of school, too. Yeah. Everybody don't want to play football. Everybody don't want to play basketball. Everybody does not want to be an athlete.
Some
people want to do music. Mm-hmm. Some people want to learn how to cook. Some people want to learn how to do arts and crafts.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to start tapping into what the children like doing. And that's something, I hear you, that's something that we as a ministry are going to do. Because I've always said in Second Chance Christian Center, before it was a global ministry, I don't mind us having seniors. So don't get it twisted. I don't mind us having seniors because I'm almost senior anyway. But I want the majority of our people to be of a certain age and younger, because that is our future.
Yes.
The more we get put into them, the greater our future will look. Because there's some people right now, sit down, I don't want you to do that. Because they're out of control. They have no self-control. They have no discipline. They can barely talk English. So, and they come from here. So that being the case, we need to start now teaching our kids again, because I remember when I first read the book of Ben Carson.
Mm-hmm.
His story was he was always getting in trouble.
Yes.
And his mama got a hold of him because mama had to work. She was a single parent. She had to work. But she was determined her child wasn't going astray. So she made him read books, do reports. And what is he now?
Yes.
I mean, if we take the time to do that, and I know it's a rough thing because there are so many parents that are not parenting.
No, it's not rough. It's not rough. And the reason why I say it's not rough, and everything that you said, that's showing the love of God. It's not rough, but the reason why it isn't is because of the fact that if you take away the electronics.
Yeah.
If you take away the Netflix, the Disney Plus, the Hulu, all of these subscription services, if you take away the laptop or the PSP or whatever the thing is, if you take away, there's time.
Right.
There's time. If you could teach them, that shows the love of God in teaching the small things.
Mm-hmm.
And then from the small things, then it grows to the middle things, and then the middle to the larger. Because, again, we've been blessed to have so much technology.
Yeah.
You know, we joke every time we see a commercial, whether it's in a magazine or whether we're just talking amongst each other, and we joke and say, wow, the Saturdays or Mondays or whatever it was during the summer, you know, our parents told us to go outside and don't come home until the sun comes up.
I mean,
the sun
every
goes
day
down. You know,
in
it's like
summer.
You know, you clean up your house, you do your chores, and now it's time to get out of the house. Mm-hmm. Oh, you go ride your bike, you go do something, but you're not gonna hang around this house,
right?
And you're not gonna go to somebody else's house to hang around their
house. No,
you're gonna
be
at
outside.
The park.
Yeah.
You're gonna be at the park. You're gonna be at the baseball diamond. You're gonna be doing something, but you're not gonna sit around. And that is one of some of the things that we're looking at and dealing with. Parents will ask, well, what can I do for my child to do such and such? Well, if you remove all that the electronics and just do some basic things, mm-hmm. then that'll change everything. Because mm-hmm. they need basic. Well, I don't know how to do that. Well, that's a perfect time for you to learn, right?
Right, there. Right.
That's a perfect. And we could share the love of God with that. You know, the, Paul says through Timothy, and he says, and Peter makes the comment. It says that the younger woman, the older women should train the younger women.
Right.
The older men should train the younger men.
Right.
Why? Because there's so much talent. There is so much information. Mm-hmm. There's so much knowledge that each generation has
right.
to share. That's the love of God.
Right.
Sharing the love of God. Sharing information.
Right.
Sharing. Teaching how to build something. Teaching how to do masonry. You know,
right,
anything. Carpentry, masonry. Crochet, mm-hmm. Knitting. You know, nowadays, some people don't even think about knitting, and the only time you hear about knitting is when they're sitting inside the nursing homes and mm-hmm. they ain't got nothing else to do. Well, that's a joke, because they're not doing that. They're not in the seniors are not doing that.
Mm-mm.
Not even close.
Mm-mm.
My grandmother never did. My mom taught my grandmother how to knit because my grandmother sewed.
Mm-hmm.
And my grandmother taught my mom how to sew. So sewing and knitting was the thing. But Granny did not, and I mean she did not. When we came by the house, she was not knitting. She was sitting there, she just got finished either watering the grass, she didn't have any pets, trying to mow the lawn, because we'd have to restrict her from mowing the lawn.
Mm-hmm.
Going up and down the stairs, to do the laundry, mm-hmm. or trying to clean up the house, mop the floor in the house. It's like, Granny, we could take care of that. You know, my mom kept us going in that area. But those kinds of things, it came to our minds.
Yeah.
We were listening, we were watching. I'm 61 now and feel blessed. It seems like yesterday that all of that happened.
Yeah.
And, you know, however, those are the things that I learned. I learned small things. And they're still coming around, but it's the small things that the love of God wants to share
right.
for us to all grow.
Right.
And then, in addition to that, to share it with others. Mm-hmm. And when I say others, I'm not talking about necessarily the children. I'm talking about other adults.
Well, yeah, because they need those basic life skills, too.
Right. As we've said, children are having children.
Mm-hmm.
The children that are having children are the ones that don't know how to take care of the children. Their children.
Well, no,
so
no, no.
They need to be trained.
Some people that are old enough that ought to know how are having children and don't take care of them either.
Right, right.
So, you know, there's been such a breakdown in things. I mean, yes, we are blessed to have the technology that we have, but we have allowed that technology to begin governing the way our lives mm-hmm. are altered. And I, you know, I'm guilty. I was a single mom a good bit of the time. So Lion King, Hocus Pocus, Little Mermaid, they watched Frankie while I got dinner together.
But hold on. You had a video, right?
Yeah.
You had the VCR.
Yeah.
We all know the VCRs were not necessarily the adult's friend.
Yeah. Well, they were his friend. He knew how to take care of them.
So if a child could learn how to use the VCR, they were learning quite well. It wasn't,
well,
you know.
Well, but he still had to get outside
right.
and play. Uh-huh. They knew they had to play. They could have time to do. Well, I mean, and we didn't really have electronics like that anyway. Cell mm-hmm. phones did not exist. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the girls at least were grown when cell phones as we know it were mm-hmm. something that they would consider having. But there were a lot of things that were not available, but you know, it's still just like we weren't allowed to sit in the house. Mm-hmm. I didn't allow my kids to just sit in the house and do nothing. And that's one of the problems is that we're not monitoring what our kids are doing. We're letting mm-hmm. them sit there with their eyes glued to whatever, which is really not good for their eyes anyway.
No, it's not.
And, you know, they're learning no kind of social skills whatsoever, you know. And if their parents don't have social skills, that don't help either. So we got to get better at finding things to do. We gotta do things for the adults and not focus as much or so much on the kids. But adults are kind of like, unless they want to learn, they're
already fixed in their own
mindset.
Got
time for that. But little kids and even teens, if they see where your heart is, I mean, and it there's even a level for me where I'm going, I'm not a teacher, y'all. I already said it. I'm not a teacher. I'm not going to keep going over and over and over again with Johnny, not your brother, Johnny, but I'm not going to keep going over and over again with Johnny as to why it is you should sit down and be quiet. I'm not going to do that because I'm a mother. Mm-hmm. That's not in my nature. So that's why I'm not a teacher. But if we take the time to get them, because I see with the youth in our ministry that are just now getting to know us, they've just been with us since January when we started having Bible study in person. And they still seem a particular way, but I noticed from the other Sunday when you called one of them up with Dave, he looked like he don't want to be up there, but he kept looking at me smiling too, so I know we are getting them. It's kind of frustrating that we ain't getting them as fast as I would like them to go, because you should be like on point.
Right.
That's me. You should be happy I'm up here talking to you. But if we take the time, even now, to find something to vest them in that has nothing to do with electronics, or even if we do electronics like you did during the virtual, if you teach them like you taught your kids how to make beats and stuff like that, if we can't pull them away from the electronics, we need to find a better educational way to teach them, to stimulate their minds and make them want to do it. Because at this point in time, they have so many different things going on that if you're taking stuff away from them as a means of punishment, as opposed to the punishment we used to get, they just have something else to do, and then they go to school, they got computers and all that stuff. So there's really nothing there. We got to get them excited about the simple life basics, because those things that are life basics are going to be the things that help them become pivotal to society anyway.
Right. And that's showing the love of God when you can learn the basics.
Yeah, and it's crucial
when you learn those basics, you realize, okay, life isn't that hard because I've learned the basics.
Right.
I actually know how to read. I actually know how to follow directions. Mm-hmm. I actually know how to drive. Mm-hmm. I actually know what the laws mean and what they say.
Right.
Because I'm going to obey them, considering the fact that I got correction at home. It wasn't correction of an item taken away, it was a correction of a worn behind.
Mm-hmm. So, that's what I was saying. They don't get the kind of punishment we used to get.
So they got our attention very well.
Right.
Our attention very well. But those things that are, that's the love of God when we learn the basics.
Yeah.
Those basics are life skills. Those basics are things that grandparents, great-grandparents can teach the young ones, the teenagers, and everybody constantly.
Right.
It's a constant growth pattern of teaching. Mm-hmm. Because if that, and it has been broken, that chain of growth pattern of teaching that has been broken, there's generations that don't have a clue because the chain has been broken. Mm-hmm. It's time to reattach that chain, and it's time to say, okay, let's close that gap.
Yeah.
We need to teach you about simple things.
We do.
Let's talk about, now that we do have banking apps, let's talk about banking apps and what are we going to do in creating money? What are we going to do? And that's the love of God. Mm-hmm. It's just that simple. It's not that hard. Or we want brand new clothes. And most of us are saying, well, let me go and go to Macy's or go to the big stores. You can actually get brand new clothes at some of the off brand places, Marshalls, TJ Maxx.
Yeah, DFWH.
And that's showing the love of God. Mm-hmm. That's saying, hey, you can get the same item.
Mm-hmm. And they are name brand.
Brand new, name brand. for less.
Yeah.
As simple as that. That's showing the love of God. And all we need to do is what? Just step out there.
Yeah.
Just step out there. It doesn't take much, but a lot of people think it does.
Yeah.
They say, well, I can't gather all the children. All you need is one. Maybe two. Okay? Take them someplace. Show him this. Show him that.
What are you gathering them for?
Well, I'm saying, when I say gather them, take them away from their natural so-called habitat of sitting around and with electronics.
Well,
let me pull you away from that.
Yeah, if you get them all together, that was one thing I loved about my dad, but I didn't like about my dad, because my dad was the only dad in the neighborhood, and my dad was kind of gruff. But he was yet the only dad in the neighborhood who would come out and play with us, all the kids, not just his kids. He played with all the neighborhood kids. When the ice cream truck came, he bought everybody ice cream. And ain't nobody else's dad doing that, so why am I dad doing that? He could just get it for us. But, you know, I like that about him, because he incorporated all the kids in the community. So when we talk about rounding people up, they had a story about a young lady, I forget exactly where she is, but she is here in Dayton, and they call her Aunt somebody. It was a story that was on just like last month. And she reaches out to all the little kids in her community. They look forward to seeing her when she's coming home. They all run up and see her, and they tell her about how their day has been. We need more of that. I mean, if we take the time to interact with the youth in our communities, I mean, and it could be such a thing. Don't be a creeper, but you can go to the schools when you know the school has something going on.
Right.
You can go to the school. You can be, they have the grandparents program at the... They have it through the AmeriCorps, but I don't know if they do now, but they did when the girls were here in DPS. They had where the parents could sign up and come and be class liaison and all that stuff, because our girls did that all the time. They were always active at the school and stuff. We can do that. We can go to the school and be an active grandparent or what have you, so we can spend time getting to know the kids, getting to know the needs of the kids, getting to know the needs of the school, getting to know different things, because a lot of times the kids will act up because they know that you can't say a particular thing to them. They know you can't do a particular thing to them. But Mrs. Jordan, on the other hand, I can give you the stank eye. Because again, I'm a mom. I know how to look at you to make you stop doing stuff.
Right.
So, and then because I'm not there regularly, then I want to be good and I want to impress Mrs. Jordan because I'm a good kid. When we know you the baddest one in the room. But they don't want Mrs. Jordan to know that.
Right.
So if we could get together and interact with them and be at the schools, be more present. I mean, not every parent that is not parenting is not parenting because they're a bad parent. Some of them don't know how to parent. Some of them just tired because they're doing all that they know how to do.
Right.
So if we all come together, that's why it takes a village to raise a child. It takes the whole community to come together and be a part of the child. Quit smiling at me like that, because I know that means you got ideas going on in your head. So they're going to cost me later. So, I mean, but we have to vest our children.
Yes.
We have to vest people. That was one thing, and I've mentioned this before. That was one thing that was heartbreaking when I was in the neighborhood core, is we wanted to make sure that the people in the community were vested. And everybody's mindset was more so that, you know, I just come home and I go to work. I come home, go to work. I mind my business. Mm-hmm. Well, because we spend so much time minding our business, we don't know what's going on around us until something bad happens.
Yes.
Or something that's not necessarily bad, but we don't want to see is going on somewhere close by. Whereas if we're taking the time to get to know each other, I mean, you ain't got to be in all everybody's business. You ain't got to be everybody's friend. Because some people you don't want to be friends with anyway. But you have to have some kind of knowledge about your surroundings.
Yes.
Some kind of knowledge about who's in your town. Because as you said, there are little kids that go up and down the streets pass your house all the time.
That's right.
So, I mean, while you being nosy, looking at your neighbor, seeing what your neighbors is doing, why ain't you watching that kid to make sure ain't no vans pulling up to talk to him or anything like that, to make sure you're making sure they're staying safe.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is all of our job. That's whether they're your kid, your grandkid, think about if they were your kid or grandkid, because somebody is always somebody's something.
That's right. That's right.
Is somebody's mom, somebody's sister, somebody's brother. So think about if that were, if you had a grandkid that young, would you want somebody to be looking out for them? Especially in a day and age when so many parents have to leave for work before time for the kids to go to school.
So many
parents have to be at work when it's time for the kids to come home.
That's right.
You know, you ain't got to be a creeper. You ain't got to be sitting on your porch rocking, hey, little girl, hey, little boy. Nope, don't do that. But you can be watching them to make sure that nobody else is messing with them. Because, again, we don't know who's going to be the next, say, president. I mean, you know, what if President Obama got kidnapped as a kid? Because the neighbors weren't watching. Mm-hmm. He wouldn't have been president.
That's right.
Somebody has to take the job and the initiative to look out for the community. You know.
Show the love of God.
Yeah.
It's just that ample.
You
just that
mind simple. Your own business,
show
but still.
Show the love of God.
Look and see what's happening. Yeah. Because that's important.
It is.
The love of God is important.
It's very important. When we look at what we've talked about all this time, let's take a quick look up here on the screen. Now, this is our background, our backdrop. As you see, we were flying the plane. Here we were over at another church. We're in Mount Eden. Below that, we were in Ontario. Mm-hmm. But we were showing the love of God even there.
Mm-hmm. We're at Air Force Museum.
At the Air Force Museum, and that's free. You can still go there.
Yeah.
I forgot where this
that
was.
Kings Island.
Was that Kings Island?
Island Zoo, and I think that was at the family reunion.
So Black at festivals, reunion you can show the love of God. When the festivals are free, and there's kids that don't know anything about it, just mention about it. Show the love of God and say, hey, let me introduce you to this and find out what your parents or whomever's taking care of you. Find out and let them know, hey, there's a free festival that they can go to and learn about something totally out of their norm, out of their character, and out of their neighborhood.
And Ohio is good for festivals.
Definitely. There's one coming up here in Dayton. For those of you who don't know, it is the this coming Sunday is the Funk Festival.
Funk Festival at Levitt's.
At Levitt's. Mm-hmm. And then that weekend
African American
Festival at Island Park.
Cultural Festival.
Festival at Island Park.
Saturday and Sunday.
Show the love of God by sharing the community and sharing with the community what festivals are there. Why? Mm-hmm. Because it teaches about culture. It teaches about yourselves. It actually encourages you to step out of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
Because you've never been there. You've never done this. You've never seen that. You never tried this.
Mm-hmm.
Comfort zones are a terrible excuse to be selfish.
Yeah.
They really are. I mean, you know, you get in that attitude, you get in that manner, well, you know, I really don't want to know about them or this has nothing to do with me. Well, here's the thing. They're not living too far away from you.
Yeah.
Those
same
people.
It does have something to do with you.
It has a lot to do with you. I think the weekend before there was a Celtic festival.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee you, all of those folks in the Celtic festival, especially the visitor, the audience, were right here local, right here in the greater Dayton area. There may be a few people from out of the state, out of the city.
Yeah, because they had the Celtic Festival and the air show were the same weekend. We actually met a family.
From Ontario, Canada?
When we were out at the grounds the day before the air show actually started, and they just happened to be coming through town and found out that the festival was going on, and we let them know about the Celtic Festival also. But I mean, we're quick to say, well, there's nothing ever going on here. There is never anything to do. You are not looking hard enough, because there's always something going on.
There's always something to do.
At the Art Institute, you could go there and they have different things going on. Like you said, the different festivals going on. They have different things at the library. And, you know, what better place for a kid than at the library? Oh. I mean, it's surrounded by books. So, you know, while you're there, and you can encourage the kids to read and stuff like that. Because again, if we focus more on things like that, the kids would get vested in more stuff. I mean, I loved to go to the library when I was little.
Oh, you know, yes.
When we kept the grandkids the other year while Tier was going to school for her massage therapy license, I would take the grandbabies to the library and they loved it, you know. And now they're, what, 13 and about to be 15. But, you know, they still have a love for that. Still got their electronics. But they still have a love for going to the library and stuff like that. Because that is putting culture into our kids. That is teaching them there's something other than Facebook, YouTube,
TikTok,
video games, all that stuff. There's something more to that. And there's nothing wrong with the TikTok and all that stuff.
Right.
But you have to do it in moderation. I mean, because kids need to be around other kids to get social skills.
Oh, yes.
You know, that's even if you're homeschooling them. Yeah, I know sometimes parents at this day and age don't have faith in the public schools or even the charter schools, so they homeschool their kids. But the kids still need to interact.
Sure
so do. You still need to find some kind of like library program or community program that the child can participate in. And there are plenty that are free. You know, there are so many arboretums around here, it's ridiculous. So, I mean, and they have like a housing portion where they have like stuffed animals, and I don't mean teddy bears, I mean like stuffed bears, you know, stuff like that, where they can go and learn about nature, they can learn about the different plants. I mean, there's so many hiking trails in Ohio, and along all the trails, there's different plants and stuff that you can teach the kids about. There's so much to learn around here. There's no excuse for us not to be vesting our children into our community. And as an adult, you might love doing that too, getting back to nature.
Now, I know some of you are saying, you all just went all the way around the circle. I thought
you
were talking about
the
love of God. We were. We were talking the love of God of sharing.
Yeah.
The love of God of causing interest, the love of God of venturing out, getting away from your comfort zone, the love of God by learning how to love others besides yourself.
Right.
That is very simple. It's not that hard.
No, it's not.
It's not that hard. Most people, they think of more ways what not to do, and they miss out on the opportunities.
Right.
They miss out on the opportunity, seriously.
Right.
Well, our time has come to an end. We hope that you enjoyed the time.
Yes, it's been a blessing.
As we always end our broadcast, based off of Mark 9:23, if thou canst believe,
all things are possible to those that believe. We love you guys. Have a blessed month, and we will see you later.